Hey guys, my name is Stefan.
And we are seniors at Queen's University of Charlotte. We started going to Center City a year and a half ago.
Yeah, I started going a year and a
half ago. Yeah, I've been going since my freshman year. Yeah. A group of us girls invited me to go my freshman year, and they were like, no pressure, this is the place you go to if you want to come. And I went the first Sunday, and I loved it. And then he started coming when we started dating. I brought him along. This is Lulu. She is the newest addition to my family. She's 8 weeks old and the cutest thing ever. We're both education majors.
Yep, both education majors. I start student teaching in the spring, and
I start next fall in August. We both came from different places in the U.S. So I'm from Colorado.
I'm from Florida.
And we both came to Charlotte because of athletics. So I'm on the swim team.
And I'm on the wrestling team.
And they both have really great programs and a really great education program. He was actually a nursing major when he started out.
I was, and then I definitely switched.
And he switched to education, and that's kind of how we met. And yeah. I'm trying to think of something else.
We're boring.
We love to go out to eat.
Oh, every weekend we go out to a new restaurant in Charlotte, because Charlotte has so many places to eat.
Yeah.
We love going out and on adventures, just around the city. It's just so nice out, especially now when the weather's getting a little bit cooler. We both actually got cats together as well. So she got her kitten Lulu, and I got my kitten Zeb, who's not here with us right now. Zeb,
no. And my they're mom. Siblings.
Yeah, but.
So they come and play with each other often. So yeah, we love the Charlotte area. We love Center City, and it's helped us grow in our faith. And we're excited to continue going and learning and growing.
Growing together and through faith.
Yeah. Thanks. Bye guys.
We're so glad that you're here to worship with us today. Whether you're here for the first time or you've been with us every single week, we're so excited that we get to dedicate this time to worship together as a church family.
And we have some exciting news for you guys. Coming November 1st, we're going back to our 10 o'clock service in person and online. It's going to be some great, great services. And we also have our full family life ministry opening up from nursery all the way through youth. So we're excited to see you guys in the building and can't wait till we can worship together.
Yeah, and I know it's really easy to feel disconnected when we're not able to worship corporately, but the beautiful thing is that God meets us right where we are. And so, you know, I know it's easy and tempting to not want to sing or lift your hands, but something amazing happens when we begin to worship. So I know it might feel weird, but yeah, you're sitting at home, stand up, lift your hands, be free to celebrate the goodness of God. Something is just, it's incredible, you know, whether we're in person or whether we're at home, the beauty of God is always worthy to be praised. And so when the message, you know, time comes, get your Bible, get your journal out, and be expectant to hear what God has to say to you.
And with that said, service is almost started. So grab your coffee, forget your chores. Let's get ready to experience God together today as a family.
Good morning, church. Let's stand to our feet and let's worship the Lord this morning. Are you thankful to be in the house of the Lord?
I'm ready. morning, Center City Church family. We are so excited that you guys came in and worshiped with us. If it's your first time with us or your 500th time, welcome home. As you're seated, say good morning to someone next to you, a little elbow high five, but you guys can feel free to go ahead and take a seat with us this morning.
There we go. Yes. Listen, in light of our current season, everything that is going on, we're taking all the necessary steps to try to create as safe of an environment as possible. So in order for us to do that, we all have to kind of play our part. So what we're asking you guys to do is when we come in here, you'll see a QR code in front of the seat that's in front of you. All we're asking for you to do is if you have your phones, you can pull out your phone, open your camera, and then all you do is just kind of line your camera up with that image, and a link will pop up on your screen. Click it. Less than 30 seconds, you just answer the basic stuff. It helps us to know who was here. If you're online, all you have to do is go to CenterCity.Church and then /what's up, and you can fill out your information there as well. Again, it won't take you long at all for you to do that. But this just helps us to know, first of all, that you were here with us. Second of all, in any case where something were to have happened, we know exactly how to contact you and keep you guys informed of what's going on.
Awesome. We're super excited to announce that since giving and online giving has become so popular these days, we're excited to announce that Center City has partnered with Push Pay, which is our new online giving platform. If you want to go ahead and you can go over to centercity.church/give, you will go ahead and see a link for Push Pay on there. Push Pay is the world's leading online digital church giving platform for over a decade, so they're awesome. They are user-friendly. If you are not too sure about what giving online looks like, we promise they're super easy, super user-friendly. If you are used to kind of giving the old way that you've been used to, we encourage you to do that through the rest of the year, but go ahead and fill out a new application to go through all of that. Go ahead and get your account set. And if you are used to giving online through texting, you can go ahead and text our new number, which is 77977, and text CCCLT to that number to give online or give through texting this morning.
Yeah, and we also have the box set up. So if you want to just give traditionally, you can drop it in after service or even during worship time. So in this time, giving is one of those like tricky things, because sometimes people feel like, oh, they're really just trying to convince me. So they're trying to give me a really sad story, like those dog commercials, where it's like, man, they make me feel so sad. And the music is just like, we never want to give grudgingly. You never want to give like out of guilt. But what I've come to realize is in my life, like in our life, we walk by faith. We don't walk by sight. And sometimes our biggest security is our bank account. So I don't know about you, but man, my faith level goes like this when I get my refund check. Because I feel like, ooh, like I'm good, I'm secure. The Lord's got me, you are good, Lord. And I get more generous. But when it goes down, just natural fear wants you to kind of hoard. And it imprisons me. One of our greatest ways of being truly free is when your pocketbook, your bank account no longer just is heavy on your heart. And you know, I give, Lord, in faith, and I trust that you got me. So I just encourage you, as you kind of keep moving through the storm, I know everyone's jobs have been affected in one way or another. Maybe you're not bringing in the same amount as you used to. Like, God knew all of this was going to happen. And it does not make him less of a provider for us. He still wants to move. And oftentimes when we take steps of faith is when we allow him to make the biggest movements in our lives, because he sees that we look to him and not where our account is. So I just want to encourage you, and I want to pray for you as we keep moving forward. And we have all these opportunities to learn how to walk in faith in a new way. Allow your giving to be a way that you discipline yourself to walk by faith, so you enter into just a new realm with the Lord of just intimacy. Father, I lift up everyone that is in this room, myself included. Father, I pray that we walk by faith, not by sight, not that we're not givers that give when we have, but that we trust that you truly are our Lord, our provider. And even when money seems to be low, we've seen so many stories and accounts where people gave their last and you just came through. Father, we want to know you in that way, the God that comes through. So I pray that you build our faith, Father, that you lift everyone up, that you let them know that you'll never leave them nor forsake them. And as they give, Lord, Father, just may they feel your presence and know you're there in a way like never before. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. If you guys want to stand and worship with us.
How many know there's no one like our God? You guys believe it this morning? Come on, if you believe it, put those hands together with us right here. Come on. Come on, keep those hands going. Let's go. Instruments he gave you. We bless you this morning, Jesus. There is no one like you, God. put all your faith and all your hope in a risen Savior this morning. Without hesitation, without any doubt, unashamed, and give him all that you have. Here's the thing, and here's the reason, church. Because when we get God, we get Jesus in our lives, he doesn't give us a little bit. He gives us all that he is. Without reservation. Everything. There's nobody else like that. Who do you know that's like that? He's the only one. Amen.
Build my I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, worship? Like, really? And yet 2 Chronicles chapter 20 says it like this: after consulting the people, the king appointed singers to walk ahead of the army, singing to the Lord and praising him for his holy splendor. This is what they sang: give thanks to the Lord, his faithful love endures forever. At the very moment they began to sing and praise, the Lord caused the army of the Ammons, the Moabs, and the Mount Seir to start fighting among themselves. The army of Moab and Ammon turned against their allies of the Mount Seir and killed every one of them. After they had destroyed the army of Seir, they began to attack each other. So when the army of Judah arrived at the lookout point in the wilderness, all they saw were dead bodies laying on the ground as far as they could see. Not a single one of the enemies had escaped. Now, here's what I'm saying. Here's what I'm saying. According to this passage, what I know is that what broke out the arm in the hand of God against the enemy of the children of God was actually worship. Yes. And hear me, because I think this is important. Listen to what they said. They, again, give thanks to the Lord. His faithful love endures forever. And the reason I think that that's so important is because there's two people in this story that needed to hear the message of the worship. It was the enemy. First and foremost, the enemy needed to know who they were coming against. You're not playing with the children of God. You're playing now with God. Because to pick on his children is to pick on the Father. And I'm not saying, you know, here's the truth. Like, you can try to size me up all you want and be encouraged by the fact that I'm short and, you know, that I'm not necessarily a bodybuilder. I don't look like I do 4 days worth of, I don't know, CrossFit. Like, I don't know Taekwondo. Like, I don't know. You can size me up. You can size up my bank account. And it'll tell you that it might not be ready for some of the economic instability. You can size up my career choice. And for some of you, you're thinking, you know, my career path is all over the place. You can size up my relationships. And the enemy would have you to think that it's about you. But remember, the message of this worship is that the God that we serve is bigger. So your worship reminds your enemy who he's squaring up against. It's not you at all. Then it also reminds the children of God that in the face of adversaries, when the stock market is making your 401k look like a 101k, when retirement that was planned for 15 years no longer looks like 30 years, where it looks like your kids are going to be out of college, married, and have their own 401k before you can retire to that little beach house that you've dreamed of, like, what it reminds us when we face issues of health and those doctor reports that just seem to be so grave, what it reminds us is, come on, his love endures forever. That you can be encouraged, that his love endures forever. I know it looks bleak, but his love endures forever. It not only reminds your enemy, it reminds you that his love endures forever. And Father, we glorify you in that love. We glorify you in that love, that regardless what we're walking through, regardless the size of the enemy, God, what we know is you're bigger and your love is close, Father. You're drawing us close that we don't have to walk alone. We don't have to walk alone, Father. That you're more than enough. Your love endures forever. What a great Savior. It's so much better your way, God. And I pray that even now, in the middle of our battles, Father, that we would rest and rely on your way and your way alone. That, Father, our worship would remind the enemy who he's squaring up against. That our worship would encourage us to remember that your love endures forever. And we'll give you the glory and the honor of it. So I pray even now that you would prepare our hearts for this moment. Yes. As we open and examine your word, that we would allow it to transform us, God. That your spirit that's alive and active, that's sitting here in-house, God, that's meeting with people in living rooms online, even now, that your spirit would begin to do the work of transformation in us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. and amen. Why don't you turn around to somebody and, you know, give them a forearm salute. I don't even know what we're doing. If you're online, drop a wave in the comment real quick just so that we know that you're here. God bless you as you're seated. We got a ton of moving parts today. I'm really excited about our time together. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me if you could. I'm going to have you turn really quick to Romans chapter 12. You're going to sit there, but I'm actually going to start somewhere a little bit different. If you've been with us for the last several weeks, we've been talking through this series we've called One Another, One Another. And we've been talking about what it means to live in a world of division and still represent the unity that God calls us to represent. And John chapter 13, verse 34 and 35 has been kind of our key verse throughout this. It says this: "So now I am giving you a new command, love each other. Just as I loved you, you should love each other." That we've been talking through this idea that the way that we love each other is a reflection to the world of the love that we've been given through the hand of God. If you haven't been with us for the last couple of weeks, I would encourage you to go back and check those out online. You can check them out on YouTube or Facebook. But in a world that's so divided, it is critical that the church stands together. Mark Twain says it like this: I built a cage and I put a dog and a cat. And after a little training, I got the dog and the cat to a point where they live peacefully together. Then I introduced a pig, a goat, and a kangaroo, some birds, and a monkey. And after a few adjustments, they learned to live in harmony together. So I was encouraged by my success. I was so encouraged that I added an Irish Catholic, a Presbyterian, a Jew, a Muslim from Turkestan, and a Buddhist from China, along with a Baptist missionary that I captured on the same trip. And in a short time, there wasn't a single living thing left in the cage. Romans chapter 12, like I said, is where we'll spend the majority of our time together. And yet, the admonishment that we find here in verse 16 simply says this: live in harmony with one another. It goes on to say, do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone's evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is at all possible, as far as it depends on you, live in peace with everyone. Amen. I want to talk a little bit about this idea of harmony. This idea of harmony. Harmony is not when we all sing the same. Harmony is when we sing the same chord. This took me like 3 days to just get my head around. Like, I walked through this with Pastor Randy. Like, it's like, okay, so help me here. Help me figure this out. And this is what we've learned. I've learned this: that harmony is different notes in the same key that create a chord. Let me kind of demonstrate that for you. Pastor Randy, would you help me out? Would you just sing a note for me? Just by yourself, one note. Okay. Now, we have some incredible singers on the stage, and I mean, not that that was bad. Thank you. That's a note.
Bring the mic a little closer.
We have Miss Marilyn with us, who's one of our incredible volunteer. She does a great job leading us worship every week. But Marilyn, would you sing the same note? Ready?
Ooh.
Oh, that's good. And then Miss Charisse, again, one of our incredible volunteers who happened to be married to Pastor Randy. She's his better half. Would you sing that same exact note? Okay, so like, we can see the potential of beauty in each of them singing the same note, but there's something unique that happens when they all decide to sing a different, again, you're going to help me with this, right? Different notes, but within the same key. Now, this is what I want to do. Pastor Randy's going to sing that note again, and then you're going to hear it in a different key. So go ahead and hit it. Miss Marilyn in the harmony. Miss Patrice, harmony. Charisse. Thank you. I even said your name wrong. You still nailed it. Patrice, where'd that come from? You hear the potential The reason this is so important is because when we think harmony, what we often think is everybody sounds the same. Same is boring. It's bland. There's no life in it. But when those three different tones all sang in the same key come together, it creates a chord and a harmony that brings life to the music. Watch this. You guys ready? Go ahead. That's a lot better. Do you notice how even within you, things start to just move? It's the beauty of harmony. Singing the same thing's boring, it's dry. Singing individually, you can hear the potential, but something is still lost. It's when we do it together that things change. Today I want to talk about what it means to live in harmony. And to help me out, ladies and gentlemen, would you give it up for Miss Ashley Cramer?
I didn't sing for you. You're welcome. So, there we go. That's it. And now John Hernandez. No. So I love this picture of harmony, but it's one thing to kind of hear it musically and see this idea, and another to say, okay, that's great. What does it actually mean to live in harmony when you're not in a choir? And so what I love about this passage is that it goes straight on to tell us what that is. When we live our lives in harmony, we're doing that when we, first of all, reject pride. So Romans 12:16, the very same verse that says, live in harmony with everyone, goes right on to say, don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people, and don't think you know it all. Some other translations translate that part to say, don't be conceited, or don't think that you're superior to everyone else. You guys, sometimes when you're teaching or preaching, God gives you a passage because he wants you to have to spend a whole week hearing that you need to reject pride, and that is what this week has been like for me, because that's one of those things that sneaks up on us, right? Like, we might think that we have it under control, and then we, like, get this glimpse of how prideful our hearts can be. And one of the ways that I saw that as I was studying this passage is the way we have this idea of social currency. Would you guys agree that there's kind of this unwritten code that there are people who are going to, like, help you out socially and you want to get to know them, and there might be people who are going to hurt you socially and so maybe keep your distance a little bit? And we would never say that because we're Christians, but we see that happening in culture. I hope I'm not the only one, but I see that and I struggle with that in my own heart. You even see it. Have you guys ever heard a husband or a wife or boyfriend or girlfriend say that they landed someone who's out of their league? I love that. I'm not saying that's wrong, because basically what they're saying is, I can't believe I ended up with someone who's so amazing. But just that idea that we have this concept of being out of their league means that we kind of have this idea in our heads that there are different leagues, and you figure out what your league is or your lane is, and you stay in it socially. This, for me, became very true in middle school. How many people, raise your hand if middle school was the best season of your life? Or if you're watching online, type it in the chat. Yeah, no one's raising their hands, because middle school is a hard time. And part of why that's hard is, at least for me, that was when I started to recognize that this was happening. Life went from all of my friends being based on proximity, because whoever was in my class was who I was going to hang out with at recess, and it was all great, to suddenly getting this idea of popularity, which, man, I hate that word. I still cringe at that, and it's been over 20 years. But in middle school, I started to try to figure out, like, well, who are the popular kids, and what do I do to get them to like me? And also, who are the kids who are going to, like, hurt my chances at that? And how do I distance myself from them? And I remember my 12-year-old birthday party, which was a huge deal because it was the first time my parents let me invite boys to my birthday party. So I was very excited and also very concerned that this would be a party that would help me out socially. And so I knew I should have been a politician, because I knew there was one boy in my class. All the girls loved him because he was cute, and all the guys loved him because he was athletic. And if I could get him to come to my birthday party, all the other kids that I wanted to come would come too. So I called him up, and his name was Stephen Losowitz. I looked him up on Facebook. He still looks pretty cool. maybe he'll watch this someday. You were very cool in sixth grade, Stephen. So I called him, and I invited him to my birthday party. And do you want to know the first question that he asked me? You might be able to guess. Who else is coming? Because all of us were thinking in that same way, who am I going to spend time with that is going to help my social standing? I was able to convince him to come, then his friends came, and then because all the boys were coming, all the cool girls came, and it was great. We sang the song from Titanic and ate pizza, and it was a wonderful birthday party. But that mentality stuck with me. And we do grow out of middle school, praise the Lord, but I think in the back of our minds, we still have this idea of this kind of social currency. The good news is that this is exactly what Paul is telling us not to do as believers, and Jesus has a great example of a story. Oops, I just opened the wrong file. A story that he tells that is basically the opposite of this, which I love because I want the kingdom of God to be the opposite of middle school. Yeah, amen. So in the book of Luke, someone has asked him what the kingdom of God is like, and Jesus replies this way. A man prepared a great feast, and he sent out many invitations. So in this time, if you were having a feast, just like you would for a party now, if you guys remember parties, you'd send out your invitations, and then your guests would tell you if they were coming, because that's when you would figure out how much food you needed. This wasn't a time where there were refrigerators, so you didn't really want leftovers. So guests who were invited would have to go ahead and say that they were coming ahead of time. So that's what we can understand when it says that he sent out many invitations. When the banquet was ready, he sent his servant out to tell the guests, come, the banquet is ready. But they all began making excuses. One said, I've just bought a field and I must inspect it. Please excuse me. Now, when I've heard people talk about this parable before, sometimes they've said that the problem with these guests was that they were preoccupied with the wrong thing. But in that cultural understanding, they were actually being really rude and going back on what they had said that they would do. For starters, they lived in a desert climate, so no one would buy a field who hadn't inspected it really, really well first. Kind of the same way that we wouldn't buy a house without putting it through its inspections. You would already have inspected that field if you were buying it. So when this person said, I can't come to your feast anymore, I need to go inspect my field, that's kind of like if I were to say, oh, I'm really sorry, I gotta go wash my hair, I can't come to your party. So then another one goes on and says, well, I've just bought 5 pairs of oxen and I wanna try them out, please excuse me. Again, oxen didn't work if they couldn't walk in pairs, and you wouldn't buy oxen if you hadn't tested them out. The same way we don't buy a car without going on a test drive. So again, what would be culturally understood here is that this person, for some reason, had decided that they no longer wanted to come to this party, and they were being really rude and just saying, never mind, without giving a good excuse. But then we have the winner who says, I just got married, so I can't come. Okay. I don't know about you, but typically, it's not true of everyone, but in this time, people planned their weddings out in advance. They would have known that this marriage was going to happen and that this party was going to happen, and the timing would have worked out great. But the thing to notice is this guy doesn't even say, please excuse me. The other guys at least tried to be polite, but this person says, nope, I can't come. And again, this is a story Jesus told. We don't know all the details of why they didn't, but you have to imagine that something happened that made them decide they didn't want to honor this host. They didn't want to be part of this party, and it may be because the host was someone who would turn around and do this. So the servant returns, he tells his master, and it says that his master is furious, which is understandable. And he tells his servant, go quickly into the streets and alleys of the town, invite the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. So these are the people who wouldn't normally get invited to a party, not just because they might not be cool or a little bit on the outskirts of things, but at this time, if someone was crippled or lame, there was kind of a cultural understanding that that was because of sin. So these were seen as bad people who had gotten what they deserved. And this master is saying, go and invite these people to my party. So the servant goes out, he invites them, and they come, and he goes back to the master, and he reports, hey, there's still room for more. So then the master says, go out into the country lanes and behind the hedges and urge anyone you find to come so that my house will be full. And that is what it means to reject pride, to be someone like that who is going to open your house to whoever it is. I love this idea of ordinary people, because all of us are ordinary people, and the kingdom of God means that we get to have a feast when we don't care about that social currency and we lay our pride aside and we are willing to enjoy spending time with ordinary people. But it goes even deeper than that. We also live our lives in harmony when we strive for honor. The next verse goes on to say, never pay back evil with more evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see that you are honorable. Now, I don't know about you guys. Honor is a word that we kind of throw around, but I was talking to John earlier this week, and I just go, John, what is honor? Like, if we're going to strive for honor, what does that mean? So then I went on a deep dive and basically found out that in our culture, we kind of equate honor with integrity. It's like doing the right thing. Did any of you guys go to a school that had an honor code? We had an honor code at my school, and it basically meant that anytime you turned in an assignment, you would write IPMH, which was short for I Pledge My Honor, and then write your initials on it, and it basically meant I didn't cheat, but kids cheated all the time. And that was like our association with honor. But the real truth of what honor is so much deeper than that, especially in the cultural context of when Romans was written and in a culture where honor is like the thing that people are seeking after the most. It's the respect that you get from the rest of the people in your group that you are living up to expectations. And so to live with honor means that everyone who's looking at you sees that you are a good person, but it also means that you honor everyone that you're coming in contact with, which goes back to a verse that John taught about last week, a little bit earlier in this chapter. There's a part that says, delight in showing honor to one another, or outdo each other in giving honor. So when I was thinking of a good example of someone who does this, clearly Jesus was the first person that I thought of. But after that, someone in my lifetime, this person came to mind. Oh, this person. How many of you recognize him? What's his name? Yeah. I wore a cardigan today in his honor. So Mr. Rogers was part of my growing up. I don't know, people of different ages may not have watched him as much as I did, but he had a children's TV show. He was actually an ordained Presbyterian minister, and he got permission from the Presbyterian Church not to have a church, but instead to have this ministry to children over the TV, which a lot of people didn't even realize. But what we did realize is that he interacted with people in a way that you felt valued, even if you never met him just over the TV screen. But if you did meet him, no matter who you were, he took the time to pay attention and to love and honor those people around him. There are stories of him, or not just stories, but clips, where he went on the David Letterman show, which David Letterman is like the most cynical comedian, late night comedian, and Mr. Rogers was on his show, and Mr. Rogers was exactly the same to David Letterman as he was talking to children on his show. He just showed him respect and honor. He was the same way when he would have kids come visit the set who just wanted to spend time with him, or if people would stop him walking on the streets or on the subway. He was known for being one who would take time to honor others. And we see in his legacy what a difference that made, right? I don't know if you guys have noticed, but the last 5 years, it's like Mr. Rogers mania. So Mr. Rogers passed away in 2003, but then our cultural climate became more of what it was, and it's like suddenly people were like, we need more people like this. So there was a documentary that came out about him, and then Tom Hanks made a movie about him, and it seems like everyone wants to learn what it is about Mr. Rogers, but I can tell you what it is about Mr. Rogers. He loved Jesus, and he would strive for honor. His wife has a famous quote where she tells people not to call him a saint. A lot of people will interview her wife and say, or his wife, and say, what was it like to live with a saint like him? And she's always quick to say, he's not a saint, because if you call him a saint, it sounds like the way he lived was unattainable. But he worked very hard to be that way, because he would strive for honor. And what I love about honor, especially when you're looking at a different culture, is that it goes beyond just this idea of respect And honor is a way that we show and experience love. I have been reading this book called Reading Romans Through Middle Eastern through Eastern Eyes that is all about how honor and shame present themselves in the book. And the author says that honor is essential to love in three ways. First, we convey that others have worth when we honor them, right? That's exactly what Mr. Rogers conveyed to me as a child watching his show. And that's what we convey to others when we decide to give them the respect and the dignity of being human. Second, I love this, the way believers show honor in Romans 12:10, which is that passage that says delight in showing honor, it undermines distrust, shame, and discord that stem from the competition for status and praise. Has anyone noticed distrust, shame, and discord stemming from competition in our culture lately? If not, do you live under a rock? What an opportunity it is for us as the church to choose to live in harmony, to strive for honor, and not to look like the craziness of discord, shame, and distrust that are coming from this competition. And finally, when members of the body show honor this way, when we love one another by honoring one another, no one lacks the honor they desire. When we honor each other this way, I don't have to figure out the person that I'm going to call to come to my birthday party so that other people will come, because I know that everyone loves me and honors me. And then I know that I get to love and honor all of you, and that is what it looks like to live in harmony. And there's one more point, but that one goes to John Hernandez.
Thank you, Pastor Ashley. Give it up for Pastor Ashley one time. That whole message, you got me. I'm thinking of sixth grade Ashley being held up by some other girls in her house going, near, far, wherever you are.
It was a boy-girl party, so the boys were holding me.
Oh, there you go. Sorry. My bad. Didn't know it was like that in the Cramer household.
God's done a work.
That's it. He's done. Oh, if you're following with us online, you're following us with notes. Point number three, in order for us to live in harmony, we live in harmony when we live in peace. Verse 18, if it's possible, as far as it depends on you, you got to be cautious and take note of qualifying statements in Scripture. Here's the truth. There's only so much I can do. When it's dependent on me, there's only so much I can do. I want to speak to somebody in the room that has been giving everything they can to live in peace, only to be shut down, that abusive, it's a toxic situation. Hear me. You can't carry the guilt of that on your shoulders. According to this disclaimer in this passage, if it's possible, as far as it depends on you. But then let me make sure that you understand that this passage is written to the children of God, about the children of God. It means that for those of us who call ourselves Christ followers, that it becomes our mandate. So if it's dependent on me and it's dependent on you, that means that somehow we should be able to live in peace with one another. Live at peace with everyone. What you might not know. I want to actually pull you back to verse 14 of this same passage. Here the writer kind of gives us an idea of what it looks like to live in peace with people. He says this. He says, be happy with those who are happy and weep with those who weep. This is a challenging passage. This is a challenging passage. Again, I want you to take note that there's no disclaimers on this one. I think when it says be happy with those who are happy and weep with those who are weep, I think we like the disclaimer of, well, if it makes sense to me. I'll weep with somebody if it makes sense. Come on, I just want to pull this right out of the headlines. I'll weep with somebody once they've done all of the background work and figured out whether or not it was justified. I'll weep with them then. I'll be happy with other people when I recognize, have a good understanding of why I should be happy, of who they are. If I can understand, look, that's not, there's no disclaimers on this. As children of God, we need to learn to mourn with those who mourn. Regardless why they're mourning, I just, again, no disclaimers on this. We are rampantly moving as a culture to this place where we're lacking empathy where the church collectively has forgotten what it's like to weep with someone, not because of the justification of why they're weeping, but simply because they're weeping. Even when Jesus is navigating life, you see his empathy with the woman caught in the act of adultery. He's not trying to justify her activity. He's not trying to sit there and figure out the whys. He just, in that moment, his heart breaks with the brokenness of her heart. The church has to return to this place where we learn how to walk people through grief. Can I also tell you, we have to learn not only how to weep with people. I think this passage gets overlooked because we think, oh, well, being happy is easy. But the truth is, we struggle to be excited with people who are excited. No, Pastor John, it's easy for me. Yeah, it's real easy when they're happy about something you're happy about. Yeah, I mean, we get really excited when our football team wins, right? I don't know who your football team is. I know Pastor Randy's excited because the Bills are actually winning again. So it's been a long time since he's exercised that happiness muscle after watching football. But I can say the same thing about the Dolphins, bro. That's it. Let's talk about it. Pastor Ashley is a different person on Monday if the Panthers win. Just a totally different person. And like sports, have you noticed that if your team loses but somebody else's team wins, you begrudgingly, like that's a tough, this passage is challenging me. Can you celebrate with people when you're losing? Can you celebrate when people are receiving success in areas that you haven't received yet? When their kids are healthy and happy, when they have kids and you don't, when their marriage is going well and you're struggling in relationship just to have a boyfriend that shows up. Can you celebrate with people when they celebrate? Can I just tell you that I know that we focus a lot on the weeping with people who weep, but can I also tell you we struggle to celebrate when people are winning and we feel like we're losing? Harmony means that when people are happy, we're excited in their happiness, that when people are weeping, that we allow our hearts to be broken. It's a beautiful picture that requires ultimately this idea of harmony. And this is where the struggle of this passage is. If you notice, when Pastor Randy was trying to get everyone to sing in harmony, and he did a great job, by the way.
Thank you.
He started with a foundational pitch. He played it on a piano. You might not have heard it, but he hit three different distinct notes, again, that made one chord, and it allowed everybody to know what the pitch was. What you don't know about your boys, I'm a little bit of a Renaissance man. In sixth grade, while Ashley was singing Titanic songs, I was the best drummer in my middle school, so I decided I should show up for the band. But unfortunately, my last name's Hernandez, which puts me in the dead center of the alphabet, which means by the time they got to me, they had all the drummers. So the band director stuck a clarinet in my face and was like, I just need you to, play a G. I was like, I don't know what a G is. He was like, just take your fingers off of all of the keys and blow. P.S. Now you know how to play a G on a clarinet. Someone's like, do you play instruments? Yes, I play a clarinet. So I blowed. Perfect G. Perfect G. I got all excited. The band director's like, well, here's your instrument. And your boy was first chair in the Margate Middle, school band. I was first chair in sixth grade. My parents loved that season of my life as I was practicing when they got, I'm nailing it, Mom. First chair. And what would happen is we would come to band class. And for those, any band nerds in the house, where you at? Yeah, woo, band nerds, two of you. That's okay. If you're watching online, put a little band nerd icon. Do they even have those? I don't know. But we would show up to band class. The first bell would ring. We would have to pull out our instruments, put it together, and sit and wait for our instructor to come out. She would come out. She would bang her baton against her podium three times, pop, pop, pop. And then she would grab one of these. You guys remember these? Look, we got some band nerds in the house. This is what they call a pitch pipe. And she would hang it around her neck with this glittery, like, string, like a glittery elf threw up around her. Like, I don't know why it was so bejeweled, but it was. And she would grab this thing, and she would hit a note. This was the foundational pitch. Our response, everybody in the band had to play their instrument at that same pitch. We had to hit that same key. Listen, she wasn't expecting us to play the same sound because it's ignorant to think that a tuba can sound like a clarinet, can sound like an oboe, can sound like a French horn. But she was expecting that we would all hit the same pitch because foundational pitch is critical to create music. So here's my band instructor moment. Class, open your Bibles with me to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19, so I can give you your foundational pitch. So now you Gentiles are no longer strangers and foreigners. You are citizens along with other with all of God's holy people. You are members of God's family. I just want to pause. Welcome home. You're part of the family. Well, Pastor John, what's the family look like? I'm glad you asked. Verse 20, together we are in this house built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, watch this, and the cornerstone of Christ Jesus himself. We are carefully joined together in him, becoming a holy temple for the Lord. Let me paint the picture. The cornerstone of the house, the first stone that's laid, the foundational pitch is Jesus and only Jesus. It's the cornerstone, the foundation. It's the reason we can live in harmony. It's the reason we can reject pride and strive in honor and live in peace with one another because I don't have my own agenda. I'm not worried about other things that connect us. The one thing that's consistent is the cornerstone of Jesus, only Jesus. When that cornerstone's politics, the house crumbles. When that cornerstone is social issues, that house crumbles. And I'm going to tell you, it's not that these things are bad. These things are important, but they're not cornerstone issues. The moment you walk into the church and everyone looks the same and thinks the same, well, then I'm going to tell you that there's other cornerstones that you've established that church upon. But when there's a diversity of thought, of diversity of origin, when there's different notes singing in the same key, with the foundation that is Jesus and only Jesus, we sing in a harmony that the world can't ignore. Again, back to this beautiful, incredible worship band. I want you to see what this sounds like. Just for a moment, Pastor Randy, would you, with this song that we love so much, Oh the Blood, I want you to hear what it sounds like when we live in harmony together. Different notes.
But the blood of Jesus.
All in the same key.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
All three together.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Would you stand and join me with your communion elements? I want you to lend your voice to this harmony. What I simply mean by that is, as we gather together in communion, what we're unified by is the blood and life of Jesus. So even now, as you take your communion elements, I'm going to ask you to kind of peel back that first layer as we consider his body.
That has just messed me up this week is that verse, rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. Not just because of the way John talked about it, but it means that we have to be willing to let people know when we're rejoicing and they can rejoice with us. We have to let people know when we're mourning so that they can mourn with us, and that can be a scary thing. But what communion is a time for all of us to come to the table, for those who are rejoicing and grateful for the way God is moving in their lives, and for those of us who are mourning and questioning and not understanding what is going on. And we come around the fact that Jesus laid his body down for us on with his disciples. Well, it wasn't communion then, it was the Last Supper, but he took the bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body broken for you." And the promise that we have, he says, "Whenever you eat this, do this in remembrance of me." We know that he laid his body down so that we can be whole. So for those of us who are mourning, who are looking for healing, we know that we have that in Jesus around the communion table. And it might not be in the timing that we want it to be, but we can rest assured that he has promised us healing forever because his body was broken for us. Will you pray with me before we take the bread? God, I pray for each person in this room or watching online. You know those places where we are even afraid to let people know that we are mourning, that we are in need of healing, because we don't even know how to have the faith that you can heal us. But God, we know the power of your sacrifice on the cross. I pray right now that people in need of healing would have the faith to ask. And God, in the power of Jesus, we pray that you would do a mighty work in our hearts, in our bodies, and in our community. We thank you for the sacrifice that you made for us. The body of Christ broken for you.
In the same way he took a glass of wine, which was representative of his blood. And we lose sight of who was around the table. He had a ragtag group of disciples who we've created saints out of, but the truth was, even around this table, they were all over the place. You had those who would deceive one another. You had those who would be deceptive to Jesus, those who would betray him. You had those who fought for political power and positioning, those who got their mom involved. They had some mama boys around the table. Like, you had this group of a bunch of people who quite honestly weren't worth the seat they were sitting in. And yet, he called them to the table. He has called us to the table. And his message isn't just that there's healing for your body, but that there's, through his blood, redemption for your heart, that you would be made whole. He said, do this in remembrance of me, that every time we take communion collectively, we would remember that we have been called to this table, undeserving and unworthy, but his blood has paid the price for our sins in order that we could live fully. Even now, with your head bowed and eye closed, can you just for a moment remember what you were when he called you to the table? Remember who you are now after years of living in close proximity, and still remember collectively. Father, we remember collectively that it's your sacrifice that paid for the remission of our sins, that by your blood we are made whole in right relationship with the Father. It's not a seat we deserve, but you're calling us to the table. So we do this in remembrance of you. Take together. Now, for those of you who are maybe watching online, or maybe you're here, you're saying, listen, I love this idea of unity, but the truth is, I'm missing that foundational tone, that key, that one truth. I'm all in until you said Jesus. And here's what I'm telling you, that he came that you would have life, and life in a more abundant. We say it here, that you would be made wide awake to his love and fully alive to his purposes. He made his son available that you could be made whole, and all it requires is that you would accept the sacrifice. So again, whether you're in-house or watching online with every head bowed and eye closed, if that's the decision you want to make today, if you want to step into this family of God, that you would make the right decision to step in and be made right with the Father, this is your opportunity. So even now, Father, I pray for every person who's ready, that as they declare that you are Lord and Savior, that they would become wide awake to your love and fully alive to your promises. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Welcome home. Welcome home. Welcome to the family. A couple things before we're dismissed. I just want to keep you up to date. Next week, pound it out. Boom. We've been working really hard. 10 o'clock. o'clock. We are back to our 10 o'clock time. So that gives you like, is it 2 extra hours to sleep technically?
Yes, so don't get confused. Next week, the time changes. So we fall back an hour and the service time changes, which means we'll be here at 10 o'clock, but it will be 2 hours later than it was today.
So let me give some of you guys hints. Just come like normal 9 o'clock service and you'll get here about 5 minutes early. And it'll be great. It'll be absolutely great. No, 10 o'clock, and we are opening all of our children's ministries, which we're really excited about. We got a bunch of moms who are sitting at home with some babies. Bring your babies. We get a chance to love on them. You get a chance to hang out with us. We would love to see you back next week. If, again, you have not had a chance to do it, located in the front of you on the seat pockets, there is our What Up QR code. That is our chance to just make sure we're doing our due diligence when it comes to this corona issue. So just go ahead and pull out your cell phone. If for some reason you have complications with that, just CenterCity.Church/WhatUp or what's up. What's up with an S, not without the S, because that's I tried, but they're saying that's too thug, John. You need to slow it down. So I did. God bless you guys as you continue to love Jesus and change the world. We'll see you next week.
I'll find you. I'll find you.